Shakti sips a fragrant tea, and before I can tell her of my outing in the bookstore, she tells me she has booked a silent meditation walk with peripatetic monks. And right as she says this, three monks in saffron-colored robes walk into the lobby. Two of the monks are twins, lanky and tall, with large eyes. One a boy, the other a girl. The other, in great contrast to the two of them, jolly and fat. They must be in their late 20s. Each have beautiful, open and relaxed, knowing and playful smiles. Into the lobby now come six others to join our pilgrimage. A Danish couple with dreadlocks and walking sticks, an Orthodox Jewish woman with a fiery red wig, a Stoic priest, and two young women lovers with fez hats, and us, the two San Franciscans, playing Shakti and Shiva. For a moment, I think we are in the Buñuel film, The Exterminating Angel, wherein a group of wealthy guests find themselves, after a lavish dinner party, for some inexplicable reason, unable to leave. Bodhine, whose name in Sanskrit means awakening, one of the tall monks, takes out his phone and shows us a map, pointing out our path through the labyrinthian streets of Varanasi, and then into the countryside, onto the Tibetan temple and Buddhist monastery in Sarin, a short 10 kilometers away, where we are to arrive for evening prayers. His twin, Opami, which means infinite light, tells us Sarinth is not far from where Gautama, the Buddha to be, attained enlightenment, and the place where he now, enlightened, gave his first sermon on Dharma just after. For the Buddha, mind and body are two aspects of the same thing, she says, with beautiful elongated fingers. When you find it difficult, withdraw and allow the Buddha to take your place. Allow the Buddha to walk within you, and also allow the people dear to you to walk. You don't need to make any effort at all. Feel your foot touching the earth mindfully, and you arrive in the here and the now. I keep noticing the beautiful smile of the rotund, happy Buddha-like monk, Banzan, whose Sanskrit name means indestructible mountain. He is to me Baba. It was as if he had this divine love, and in looking at him, all my worries seemed to melt away, and I submerged myself in his grace. A Baba is a rich sponge cake, typically soaked in rum-flavored syrup. I love this way of thinking of him. We will walk silently, Opami says, and if someone needs something, just put your hand up. And so off we go, our rather eclectic group. We make our way along the ghats, onto the dense city streets, through hectic traffic roads, and soon we are in the countryside, passing brick factories and the lush green fields where farmers, ankle deep in mud, are harvesting rice. We walk along the river and through the fields. I think about what a meditation is. There are many kinds of meditation, literally hundreds of meditation techniques, but one thing they all seem to share is the cultivation of mindfulness and awareness. In the Lotus Sutra, it is said that the Buddha loved and enjoyed a good walk, and as a form of Buddhist meditation, it can be a very deep spiritual practice. When the Buddha walked without thinking of arriving anywhere, he walked without effort. It may even be said that the supra-physical can only be really mastered in its fullness, to its heights, when we keep our feet firmly on the physical. Earth is his footing, says the Upanishad, whenever it images the self that manifests in the universe. My practice, the Buddha said, is the non-practice, the attainment of non-attainment.